good morning. Sing with us.
We waited for this day. We're gathered in your name and calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening design, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see. A mighty river flowing from your heart, healing every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we sing. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart.
Have each one of you with us this morning. We are glad to be here, thankful for the day that we have, for this opportunity. Today is the second Sunday of Advent. I'm going to have Chloe light our Advent candles for us in just a minute, but we are, it's good to have each one of you, thankful for the day that we've been given. Let me make a couple of announcements real quick. Number one, we've still got some cookbooks that we had last year for sale. They're back here on the table, so if you'd like to have one of those, I think it's $15 for one or two for 25, something along that line. If you'll see Tommy McDonald, he'll get you hooked up with that. Children's practice will be tonight at 6 o'clock right here in the Family Life Center for the Christmas program. We will have our normal service tonight at 6 o'clock. Following our service tonight at 6, we're going to have a business meeting real quick. It'll only take a few minutes, so that'll come tonight after our worship service tonight at 6. Are there any other announcements of any kind before we have a minute of prayer? Okay, all right. It's a youth Christmas party. It'll be starting tonight about 15 to 4 or so. All right. If you'll have a seat for me real quick. This one and the one, the purple one behind it, okay? Yeah. No, over here. All right. Today is the second Sunday of Advent, which is the love candle. Christ was born just as God had promised. God's people in other times waited and trusted in that promise. Our hope is in Christ, who comes into our hearts and promises to return. The candle of love reminds us Today we light a new candle. The candle of hope reminds us that Christ is our Savior. Today we light a new candle, the candle of love, to remind us that we can trust the God who keeps His Word. The scripture is Romans 10:13-17. It says, "But not all the Israelites accepted the good news, for Isaiah says, 'Lord, who has believed our message?' Consequently, faith comes by hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ." Each week, millions of people around the world gather to hear the words of God, written originally in ancient languages. The words of God are still being translated with careful precision. At first, God's word was only spoken, then written, copied by hand, and finally printed on the first printing press. And today, in every form of communication possible, the message of God is graciously given to any who would receive it. God's word calls us to trust Him. He invites us to believe His promise and His message. The prophet Isaiah of long ago understood that a message given is not necessarily a message believed. A powerful, miraculous journey begins when those who hear the message believe what they hear. If you'll stand with me, we have a prayer that we're going to pray together this morning. All right? Let us pray. Father, we have heard enough to believe. Help us not to hear only, but to trust. You have said we can live forever by trusting You. Like so many before us, we believe in Jesus. Amen. Hey, just a minute. Welcome some people around you, then we'll come right back in worship. Thank you. Just sing.
has spoke it to be. You were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were. Yeah, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out. We join them as we sing. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Creator God, you breath so I could praise your great and matchless name all my days, so let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of our King. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God.
Repeat the sounding joy.
as we continue to worship this morning, you know, the beautiful thing about joy is joy doesn't depend on our circumstances at all. Joy is found in a peace that comes from knowing the Lord, from knowing Christ, and knowing what He says about us, knowing who He is, knowing the power that He has, and that He holds us in His hand. And when you have that relationship with Him, you can have joy in the middle of any circumstance. And this morning, as we gather together on a good day, we can have joy as well, just to worship Him, just to lift Him up. And we just want to pray right now, just that we lift His name up above every name. Will you join with me? God, right now, we just focus our hearts on You. God, we just ask that You would allow us, Lord, just to know and understand that joy that comes from having a relationship with You. God, I pray right now that we would just lift up Your name. God, that we would just put all of our focus and our attention on You right now. God, in this moment, we would give You thanks for who You are and for who You say we are to You. God, we thank You for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Once again, it is good to have each one of you with us, and we are always blessed to be able to be here and gather together and gather together to worship and celebrate the one who has saved us, because there is no other name under heaven given whereby we must be saved except the name of Jesus. And so this morning, for a moment, we're going to read some scripture here in just a few minutes. We're going to start, and I believe it's Luke where we're going to start this morning. We're going to go from there, and we're going to talk a little bit in Mark. We're going to tell the story about the man that was possessed with many demons and many unclean spirits, is the way the Bible describes it. And we're going to tell his story for just a minute. And this is the second sermon in our sermon series, A Christmas Threat. And we talked about how Jesus has come to kind of uproot this kingdom that the devil has tried to establish in people's lives, these strongholds that he establishes in our lives, the things that he has power over us, you know, the thoughts and our activities and the brokenness that sin and all of this world kind of brings up on us. And all of that stuff kind of enslaves us to what it is that Satan's kingdom is all about. And it's about tearing down the things of God or resisting the things of God. And he works diligently to prevent people from becoming children of God, reborn into the family of God. And so Christ came along to be the one that has power over these strongholds and over these things that the enemy has against us and has upon us. And so there's no other name given that can save us except the name of Jesus. There is no way that we could have power over these broken areas in our life if Christ doesn't come into our life and uproot the things that has been established in our life through these evil forces and these wickedness and just the way that the devil preys on people that he's stronger than, and he does that all the time. So for just a minute, we're going to start off with a passage here. We're going to read two slides back to back. It's Luke 4, 16 through 22. And this is at a very public place in Jesus' ministry. You know, he's been baptized by John, and they're starting to get a sight of him for the first time of where he was starting off in public ministry as he proclaims himself to be the Son of God, and he's the one that's fulfilling the prophecies. And in this particular passage, Jesus has come in, and he's entered into the temple, and inside the temple, he's going to read the passage for the day. And so he goes up to the reading podium, and he begins reading the passage for the day, and we're going to read a passage that he reads here, and he reads a passage out of Isaiah. It was customary of the day for the priest would have somebody come in and read the particular passage, whatever the reading was for the day, and then they would go on about their business, or they would have a time of prayer, then they would continue on their way. Just so happened that Jesus was invited to read this particular passage. So he reads this passage to him, and we're going to stop at the end of the passage. Then we're going to talk just a little bit about it. And I want you to listen close. Like I said, this is really the first time in a very public spot that Jesus comes out to everybody and explains to them that he is the one that's fulfilling the prophecies. Luke 4 and 16 says, "And he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, the recovering of sight to the blind, and set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord.' And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister, and sat down. And the eyes of all of them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, 'This day is the scripture fulfilled in your ears.' And all bare him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, 'Is not this Joseph's son?'" Go back, if you will, Tyler, to the previous passage. I want you to listen to what Jesus claims. He says, this is being fulfilled today through him. And here's what he is claiming that's being fulfilled through him. He's been anointed to preach the gospel to the poor. He had sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, recovering the sight to the blind, and set at liberty them that are bruised. All of these are areas that the enemy has worked very hard to enslave people through the bruising or the pain that he has brought upon them, through the captives, those that he has enslaved, to the blind that he has blinded them from knowing the ways of God and knowing the things of God. He has broken their heart. He has robbed them of every good thing that they could possibly have and has left them poor. And so Jesus is claiming that he has come to undo all these things that the devil has done. He has come to repair, and he's come to fix, and he has come to make whole those that are broken and those who are, you know, in bad places and in hard times and have suffered greatly because of the way that the enemy has ruled their life, the way that the devil has ruled their life and all of this brokenness that he has brought upon humanity and upon individuals as well. And we find these people all through the Bible, especially in the New Testament. I mean, we find people that are broken in so many different ways. You know, we find them that have been, covered with sickness from being physically blind. We find them that are lame. We find them that are given over to the ways of the world with the woman at the well. And we just find them in all different types of categories. We find them greedy. We find them prideful. We find them in Pharisees who believe that they're perfect and everybody else is wrong. And we have found rich young rulers that have turned away Christ because they love their stuff too much. And we found the unclean. We found just about everybody that you could possibly imagine throughout the New Testament that is captured by some of this stuff to one degree or another. You know, they're plagued by some of this stuff to one sense or another. It may not be specifically in these areas, but Jesus is talking about bringing wholeness to those that are broken, to the ones that the enemy's broke, to the ones that he's captured, to the ones that he's hurt, to the ones that he has broken their hearts. To all of these areas, Jesus claims to be the one that's bringing healing and wholeness to that. Now, you would think this message would be received openly and with glad heart. You would think this message would be received joyfully, that one that is finally here that can deliver us from all this stuff that's got us, from this, you know, the desires of the world that we have, from the unclean spirits that live within, from all of this stuff that we have and that's going on in our life. There's finally one here that has power in an area of our life of which we've never had power over. We've never had power to change. We've never had power to bring wholeness. We've never had power to undo things that have been done. We've never had that kind of power in our life. We've never had the power to change our friends or change our families or even change our own habits whatsoever. We've never had the power to make us righteous. We've never had the power to fully resist everything that the devil puts in front of us. The flesh is too weak. And at that particular time, the spirit itself was filthy and the soul was filthy. It desired the things. They'd never had the power, never had the power to not desire the evil things that was put in front of them. Never had they had that power. Their hearts had never been changed. Their wants had never been changed. Their desires had never been changed. So therefore, they were always susceptible to the temptations of the enemy. They've never had that power. And so you would think that one coming saying, I have that power and I will give that power away and that wholeness and that healing and all of these good things are coming, you would think it would be received with open arms and joyfully. But it wasn't received joyfully. It wasn't received with open arms, and they didn't celebrate the fact that Jesus claims to be the one. As a matter of fact, they start off doubting it by saying, is this not Joseph's son? What makes him think that he's any better, any stronger, any bigger than we are? What makes him think that he has any more power than any of us have, or would know what would be right, what would be wrong better than any of us? So they start off first by doubting. And you would think it'd stop there. You would think the doubting, they would start with doubting and they would stop right there and they would go on about their business, but they don't stop there. If you're familiar with the rest of the story, you know what they do after they begin doubting who Jesus is? They kind of, a mob mentality forms, and they kind of force Jesus out to the edge of town, actually to the edge of a cliff. And the Bible says that they're ready to throw him over the cliff. And the Bible says that he passes through them and he goes on his way. These people have gotten so upset. They are so mad. They're filled with such rage that they are ready to throw him over a cliff and kill him because he has claimed to be the one that has power to fix them. Now let me ask you, what do you think's working there? Do you think it's them that's working, or it's the evil that has found a home within them that's working? It's the evil that's threatened. The worldly, the people have nothing to lose. The worldly people, the flesh and blood that was there, they have nothing to lose in a sense. I mean, all they're doing is gaining good things through Jesus. They're gaining peace, they're gaining joy, they're gaining all these wonderful things, salvation, eternal life. It's always baffled me about how people in the world resist the things of God. Because they're in a situation where they gain good things and they're just asked to give up bad things. To let go of themselves, receive who he is and what he is, and accept the good things of God. You would think any of us would run to that. You would think any of us, be it in the world or in the church today, whatever situation we found ourselves in, you would think the world would be beating the doors of the church down to get to that. Give up the brokenness and receive wholeness. Give up the sinful and receive righteousness. Give up the bad and get nothing but good. You would think we'd be running to that, but people don't run to that. As a matter of fact, they not just resist it, but it makes them mad. It angers them. It upsets them. Something about them, something within them that has found a home and has settled in their heart, it threatens that individual. It threatens that spirit, that unclean spirit that's found a home in the heart of every unbeliever, that's found a home in the heart of everyone that refuses to accept Jesus. Everyone that has decided the things of the world is more important than the things of God. The things of the flesh are more desirable than the things of God. For everyone that resists, it's that one that works within them that's threatened. Because as individuals, you and I, we have nothing but to gain. nothing but to gain, just good things, just good things. We give up our bad, we receive His good. Why anybody would resist that, sleep in this morning and not want that, is beyond me. Why anybody would decide there's other things more important and they'd rather go do that is beyond me. But the truth is, there's something that's threatened within them that don't want to give up its dwelling place. It doesn't want to give up. It doesn't want to come face to face with this power that can heal and can deliver and can establish wholeness in broken people's lives. It doesn't want to face that. It doesn't want to deal with that because it knows what Jesus is claiming here, that there is one that has power over all these things. And Jesus says, I'm that one. The perfect example of this we're going to find in the Gospel of Mark. I'm going to read through this story, then we'll come back to the beginning of it. It's a story you're probably familiar with, and you may know it pretty well. It's told in a couple of different ways. But this is the story of Legion. This is where Jesus, early on in ministry, encounters this man who is riddled with unclean spirits. And he is forced out away from the town. And he's living, the Bible says, in the mountains and amongst the tombs. So let me read this to you real quick. And this is a great example. And what we're going to talk about when we get through with this is we're going to talk about these areas that the enemy controls in people's lives and these strongholds and the particular strongholds that this man was facing and this man was dealing with, because this is a perfect example. This is the blind man that can't see. This is the lame that can't walk, spiritually speaking. This is the man that's been captive that needs to be set free. This is the brokenhearted. This is the one that Jesus is referencing from the man named Peter who wrestled with his impulses and how he handled things, all the way to Paul, all the way to this man who is filled with demons. These are the people that Jesus is speaking of. The woman at the well, the woman with the issue of blood. All of these people, from physical ailments to the spiritual problems that they're wrestling with, these are the ones that Jesus is speaking of. Here are the ones that I've come to bring wholeness to. Listen to what it says. It says, and they came over to the other side of the sea into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains. Because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him, and cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For he said unto him, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked him, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. And he besought him much that he would not send. He besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding, and all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter into them. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out, entered the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. There were about 2,000, and were choked in the sea. And they that fed the swine fled, and told it in the city and in the country, and they went out to see what it was that was done. And they come to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil and had the legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. And they saw it told them how it befell him that were possessed by the devil, and also concerning the swine, and they began to pray him to depart out of their coast. And when he was coming into the ship, he that had been possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but saith unto him, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee and had compassion on thee. And he departed and began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him, and all men did marvel. So it's a story that you might be pretty familiar with, but I want us to go back for a minute. And in the first passage of this, the first slide that we put up, everything is covered about what this man wrestles with or what's happened to this man and how he's ended up where he's ended up. It starts off by telling us that he is filled with an unclean spirit, that there are things within him that's not good, things within him that's bad. And then it begins to give us the effects of this unclean spirit. Here's what the unclean spirit does. Here's the impact that it's had on him, and here's where he's ended up, and it begins to just paint this terrible picture about what's happened to this man and why he's in the condition he's in and how he got in the condition he's in. And it all alludes back to the fact that he's been captured by these unclean spirits that they're living within. So listen to the things that's happened. It says, and they come over to the other side of the sea into the city of the country of the Gadarenes. And when it was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs, a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. There's three particular areas here that I want us to pay attention to that it identifies. Here are some of the side effects, issues with what has captured him. And literally, this man literally becomes a slave to these unclean spirits that's living within. He has become a slave to it by doing what they demand and doing what they command. And the things that he would resist, he can't resist. And the things that he would do, he can't do. And he literally becomes a slave to all of these things that's living within him. And the side effects of it have been this. Number one, the first thing that it points out to us is that he's living amongst the tombs. He's living amongst the tombs and within the mountains. And it's not irony that the man filled with these evil spirits and these demonic forces has been driven away from the living to where the dead exist. It's not irony that he's not there amongst the living. It's not coincidence that it's the tombs that he's ended up in, and it's the caves of the tombs of where he's living and where he's dwelling, and apparently naked at the time. You know, he's shed all of this stuff, and he is living away from the people, away from living amongst the dead. Let me tell you, you've heard the saying that, you know, great minds think alike. You know, you've heard them talk about kindred spirits. Listen, I fully believe that this that lives within us is what works in the relationships of our lives. Let me explain. I think the things inwardly bind us quicker than the things outwardly bind us together. I think the things that work inside of us unite us or bring us together long before the things outside of us bring us together. Even if we're raised in the same place, if we're in the same economic status, if we have some of the same friends, or if we have the same educational background, a lot of the external things look exactly alike. Things that are working on the inside of us determine if we're united or if we're divided with each other. It's the things that's working inside of us. It's the sons of disobedience will run around with the sons of disobedience. The evil spirit that works within that makes a person unclean and makes a person unfit and makes a person bound by the things of Satan, that individual will be drawn to other people that have the same like issues and the same like problems. They will be drawn to those people. Those who have resisted God will be drawn to other people who resist God. Those who run this particular way will be drawn to others who run exactly the same way. People that suffer with the same brokenness tend to flock together, and they tend to be together, and they tend to run together. And you think that's determined by our choosing at times, and to some degree, it is, because if we choose Christ or not. But this man, in this particular case, all of his relationships had been severed, and that was working inside of him determined his dwelling place. It determined his dwelling place, that lived inside of him. It determined who he was around. It determined how long he'd be around them. It determined if he would live with them or live around them or live next to them or be close to them. And it had decided that he would not be amongst the living, and it drove him out amongst the dead. Is it any wonder that those that have brought death upon mankind would want to go live amongst the dead? That's no surprise. That's no surprise. I mean, is it any wonder that those that have brought pain and suffering on man and on humanity would drive this man to that place? To that place of pain and suffering. Drive him to a place where it reminds him of nothing but death, reminds him of nothing but torment, reminds him of nothing but pure failure. So it drives this man away. And people think that has nothing to do with the people we hang around with. It has everything to do with who we hang around with. Those who have accepted Christ and have a spirit of the living God living within them are going to be drawn to other like-spirited folks. They're going to be drawn to others who are trying to clean their act up. They're going to be drawn to others who have surrendered to Christ. They're going to be drawn to others who live in the power and under the authority of Christ. That's who they're going to run with. That's who they're going to be drawn to. If they're fully alive in Christ, they're not going to be drawn to the dead. They're not going to be drawn to where the pain is constantly reminding them. They're not going to be drawn to these places. So Eve, that one that lives within, you know, Jesus describes it in the previous passage that I read. Jesus describes it as being brokenhearted. He describes it as being blind. He describes it, you know, as all of these horrible things that brokenness drives or brings upon us. All of these things working in this man's life is determining a lot about this man's life. It's not just this eternal, you know, repercussion or this eternal repercussion that's coming. It's not just about an eternal situation. That day, that lived within that man was determining who he was around, where he dwelled. Isn't it interesting? What's the one thing that the demons ask of Jesus? What's the one thing other than have mercy on us? What is the one request they make? Don't send us out of this country. Don't send us out of this country. They were ruling that man with all authority. They had complete control. They had captured this man. And he was fully enslaved to everything. Everything that they were offering and everything that they were demanding. The one thing they asked was that they could stay close to that dwelling place. That they could stay close. Isn't it interesting that the only thing they ask is to stay in that area of Jesus? Have mercy. Don't send us away out of this country. Let me tell you, these things that get a hold of us and these unclean spirits that seek to capture us and pull us away and seek to divide us and pull us away from the living, pull us away from life, pull us away from church, pull us away from family, pull us away from the good things in our life that God's established in our life, those things seek to capture us. And those things will not let go unless something bigger and stronger, like we talked about last Sunday, forces them to let go. Relationships are determined by what's working within us. People think it's not, but it is. It is. Relationships, how we handle, who we're drawn to, and how we deal with that is determined by that that's working inside of us. This man, who knows what they had tried. The next part of it that says that they had plucked the cords, they had wrapped him up in cords, they wrapped him up in chains, and wrapped him up in fetters, and he had plucked all that stuff off of him. That they had tried many ways to tame him, as it says. They had tried many ways to control him. They had tried many ways to change him from who he was. And who knows what therapeutic avenues of the days they tried. Who knows what all they tried. They probably tried many medical procedures and this and that and all different types of stuff. Mom and daddy probably got involved and tried their best to do things to change this man's desires and change who this man was and the way he was acting and all of these things. I mean, they were probably working in so many different avenues. Maybe whatever the home remedies of the day might have been, they were probably trying their best to fix this man. I mean, all the way down to chaining him up. And the Bible says that he would pluck these things off of him and that nobody could tame him. Let me tell you another pure sign that there's evil that's working within our hearts and within our lives. And it's a big one. You become completely powerless to change in your life. Over bad things that have you and captured you, you're completely powerless to change those bad things. That you have no control over those bad things. The Holy Spirit enables us and gives us power and empowers us to resist. It empowers us to change. It empowers us to become people that we could have never been on our own. It empowers us to seek after the things of God, desire the things of God, and become that person that God wants us to be. It's pure sign, pure evidence that we belong into His family is that there's this great evidence of change in our life that's been empowered by the Holy Spirit. This man was powerless to change. There was nothing within his own hand, within his own control, that he felt like he could do. And the community had tried, and the families have tried, and whoever this man was when he come through the door was exactly who he was when he left. I mean, whoever he was when they tried all this stuff was exactly who he was when it was over with. He would pluck the chains off of him and the fetters off of him to the point where they run him out of the city, away from everybody. So listen to me, there's everybody, it seems like, whatever the methods of the current day might be, they're trying to wrap people up to force them to change. Be it denomination-wise, they try to wrap people up and ask them to change, to all sorts of therapeutic avenues and ideas to try to insist that people change. And we try so many different areas, but the reality is, until something bigger happens in their life and that evil that works within, they're powerless to that change. Powerless to that change. I mean, the idea of Christ is to take wolves and recreate them into lambs. It's not to take the wolf and domesticate him, treat him how to look like a lamb and treat him how to act like a lamb and treat him how to how to do everything that lambs do. It's not to domesticate the wolf and treat and get him to act nice and to be nice and to play well with other people and to change his bad habits. That's not the avenue that Jesus takes. It's a complete death of the wolf and it's a resurrection of a lamb in somebody's life. It's the complete transformation. It's changing. And instead of taking that avenue with this man early on, which they didn't have that avenue to begin with, but they took the avenue of trying to chain up the wolf and domesticate the wolf and get him to play nice with other people because that was the only avenue they had. And unfortunately, although we have the way of Jesus today, people and churches still try to do exactly the same thing. Just get people to play nice. Just get people to be nice to each other and tell everybody to get along and let there be peace and let there be all this stuff. When we don't acknowledge the fact there are things that's working at times in our life that we're powerless to change. And unless the power of Christ and the Holy Spirit, that area is turned over to them, change isn't going to happen. And the idea of Jesus is not to redecorate a man's heart. The idea of Jesus is to tear down the old and reconstruct something new. So Jesus wasn't seeking to chain this man up. He wasn't seeking to get him to play nice with people in the town or get him to wear clothes. That wasn't his target. That wasn't his goal. His goal was to recreate this man through the power that is in Christ and create something different than what has been created. And that's what he does to every one of us. If we encounter Jesus at 9, we start this recreation process, also known as sanctification. We start this new journey that gives us the power to change bad things that come up on us in life. He empowers us. Some things have a bigger hold than other things, but he empowers us. The last thing is this, and number 5, and truly this is probably one of the saddest statements. You know, part of the picture that Jesus paints of this man. Says, and always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. I've often wondered what would take him there, what would push him there. I mean, I can understand the crying and the torment that he might be in. No good days are behind him. There's nothing to look forward to. There's no joy. There's no hope. There is no avenue of peace in his life. You know, his relationships with his family's been destroyed. He can't go back into town. He is tormented by these things that live within him and has brought him to a place of desperation and brought him to a place of depression and has brought him to a place of where he is broken in every sense of the word. And so he sits and he cries over the fact that nothing's ever going to get better. What takes one so far to where they begin to bring that kind of pain upon themselves? They begin cutting themselves. He takes the rocks, and with the rocks, he begins to inflict pain upon himself. You know, one thing that I think about in this particular passage, you know, if you hang around the dead long enough, you'll begin to think you are dead. And I wonder if out of worthlessness, this man inflicted himself with pain, or maybe out of a reminder that he's not dead, he inflicted himself with pain. You know, because joy was so far away. Peace was so far away. Contentment, all the good things, the good feelings that remind us about how good things are, were so far away from him. And pain was so close that maybe he chose pain to remind him that he wasn't dead. Whatever it was, through the knowing that there's bad days ahead, his good days are gone, and there's nothing else to look forward to, he is absolutely tormented by these unclean spirits that are ruling their house. He has become their house, and they are ruling that house day in and day out, and they determine everything about this man, everything about this man. And he's at the point now to where he's completely broken in every sense. Well, the passage that Jesus read out of Isaiah, Jesus says, I have come to make this better. They had tried everything within the community or country to try to heal this man and try to make this man better. And they were completely helpless to the power of those unclean spirits that lived within this man. But one day things changed. One day things changed. It wasn't when a new medical book was printed and they finally figured out what they needed to do for this man. It wasn't when somebody else strolled through town. Everything changed when Jesus sailed up on a boat and got out of the boat. Everything changed when Jesus stepped on the land of the Gadarenes. And it's interesting, the man that's plucking chains and the man that's throwing off these fetters and the man that's untamable to everybody else, the Bible says that when Jesus got out of the boat and he stepped on the land and said that from a distance, this man from the tombs and from the mountains came running down to where Jesus was at. Everything that worked within him, everything that he was, all this power that lived within him that caused him to cut himself and sever all these relationships that captured this man, they came running with him, within him, all the way down to where Jesus was. And they hit their knees and they fell down at Jesus' feet and they worshiped him with everything that they was. He had not yet spoken a word. He had not yet spoken to them or asked them anything. His presence brought them out of the tomb. It brought them out of the mountains, and they come running down. The one that nobody could tame fell down on his face at Jesus' feet. This is why Jesus is such a threat to the devil's kingdom, because he has so much more power than anything else that dwells on this earth. He has the power to set the captives free. He has the power to bring deliverance to them. He has the power to heal the brokenhearted. He has the power to cast out those things and empower people to change in his name. Christ has that kind of power. And the devil knows that, and the enemy knows that. So in his presence, they come begging. They hit their knees. They bow down in front of him, and they plead for mercy. Now the story goes that he sends them out, and they enter the swine. The swine runs down the hill into the sea. The city folk come out, and they begin to look at this man. The Bible says that he's set and he's clothed and in his right mind. They go back and tell everybody else what they've seen. The town gets mad, because my guess is maybe not the only one that was filled with unclean spirits existed there. So the townspeople got mad. They come out and ask Jesus to leave. The man wants to go with Jesus. And listen to what Jesus does. He doesn't let him come with him, but he sends him back into the city, back in amongst the living. He sends him back where life was, back where people were. And he says, you go back and you be an example and you tell them what I've done for you. Now think about what's happened to this man. I mean, day in and day out was nothing but one day of pain, one day of torment after the next. Jesus fills him with hope. He fills him with peace and he gives him a purpose. And he sends him back into the city, probably flat broke and don't have any relationships and probably people thinking all these bad things about him and nobody wants to be around him and all this bad stuff that goes along with him. He goes back into the city, and Jesus asks him to go back into the city and be an example. He gives him a purpose. He gives him a reason to live, because he set him free. He has made him whole. He's done all these things that he said that he would do. And all of these big, extremely powerful demons that live within this man bow down at the feet of Jesus. Let me tell you, I've got a family in my life, and I've got friends in my life who have very much taken this journey to one sense or another. They've pushed family away. They've pushed friends away. They don't want to talk about the idea of getting better, whatever that may be. They don't want to talk about the idea of being healed or being whole in Christ. They don't want to entertain those ideas whatsoever. They don't want anything. They don't want anything to do with it. So they've pushed all of that away. And they've isolated themselves. They have sunk themselves into work. They've sunk themselves into hobbies. They have sunk themselves into mischief. They have sunk themselves into drugs or sunk themselves into alcohol. They have done something to isolate themselves with, and they've surrounded themselves with all this old stuff that makes all that other stuff seem to go away. It's what they've done. And I'm going to tell you, until the day comes that Christ, they turn their life over to Christ, they're going to remain captured by that. A new job's not going to fix it. It's not going to fix it. New friends to run around with, that's not going to fix it. Bad friends is a side effect of what's working on the inside of them. All of that junk, all of that stuff we may think is going to fix this stuff that's going on in their life, it's not going to fix it. What's going to fix it is the power of Christ that sets them free from what's working on the inside of them. And until that happens, they're going to be captured and they're going to be enslaved to all of this stuff day in and day out. They're going to wrestle with it and they're going to deal with it. This is where we're going to ask Heath to come on back around. This morning, I don't know what you deal with or what you wrestle with or the things that go on in your life, but I do know this. If you want power to change things that are going on in your life, power to overcome the things that isolate you, power to overcome the things that push you away from the living, power to overcome the things that capture you, enslave you, and demand that you do this, that, or the other. The only answer to that is to fully surrender to who Christ is. Put yourself at His feet and let Him resurrect. Let Him create a brand new creature in you. Let Him do something wonderful in your life. Let Him give you purpose. Let Him give you peace. Let Him give you rest about who you are and what's happening in your life, and set you free of these forces that have a hold of you. If you'll stand up with me, we'll just have a word of prayer. We'll give you an opportunity to come pray. Father, we thank You for this time together this morning. We thank You for being with us. We thank You, Lord, for the power that we have in the name of Jesus and what it is that He brings to us. The ability to resist. The ability to be empowered to seek change and overcome these things that tempt us, overcome these things that try to capture us. God, You know what it is that we're wrestling with today, and Lord, in this house, I pray that You're very present right now. God, I pray that You're present right now. And the evil that may be abounding in people's lives, turn loose. Lord, that they can surrender to You. That they choose to take all the good that You've got and give You all the bad that they are. Lord, that they don't resist, that they don't turn away from it, but they fully surrender this morning. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. If you want to come pray at the altar over anything, the altar's open this morning.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, You rescue the souls.